CBS News interviews Dennis Walters at his Florida home. That interview was broadcast nationally during the 2010 Masters Golf Tournament.
Let's just start with golf in general. How did you get so interested in golf?
Well, I've always loved to play golf. I started playing golf when I was about 8 years old. My big dream was always to play successfully on the PGA Tour, and I was working my way in that direction when I had an accident in 1974, which left me paralyzed from the waist down.
Did you think after the accident happened, that's it, it's over, I'm not going to play golf?
Well, almost every person I met said it would be impossible for me to play golf because I couldn't stand up. Guess what? They were right. So I started hitting golf balls sitting down.
That was how long after the accident?
About a year and a half. And I really, when I was laying in the hospital bed, I never thought I'd do anything. But by being able to get back on the golf course and doing the thing that I really love to do the most, I've been able to do a lot of things I never thought I'd ever have a chance to do. I've been doing this show for 34 years. I've done over 2,800 performances, and it's been a pretty amazing journey.
Looking at your house, it's like walking into a shrine. I mean, you have letters from presidents, letters from famous golfers, incredible golf collectibles.
Yeah.
Can you imagine what your life would have been like had it not been for the accident?
I don't know. As rotten as I felt after this accident, when I came to the golf course, I felt better. So I knew for me it was good therapy. It was good physical therapy. It was good mental therapy. I never, ever dreamed I could make a career out of this, but I just kept plodding along, and it wasn't easy. It was very difficult because no one would hire me. After I got where I thought I was good enough, it was hard to get bookings, but I kept going, and I have done a lot of things I never thought I could do. I've met two presidents. I've done shows with Arnold Palmer and Jack Nicklaus and Gary Player, and met Ben Hogan, and done a couple shows with Sam Snead, Byron Nelson, and I just think it's been an amazing journey, and I never could have predicted it.
This is kind of a tough question to ask, but when you're out there on the golf course, do you ever wish that you were standing on both feet?
If I could change that, I would switch in a second. There's so many things that I can't do that I wish I could, and I wish I could play golf the way I used to. But I realized a long time ago that this wasn't going away and it wasn't getting any better, so I figured I'd try and make the best of it. And that's what I think I've done, because I think I basically maxed out. I don't think I could have done more. I couldn't have tried any harder. I couldn't have worked any harder. I couldn't have done anything else to make a go of this, and so I'm happy with that. But I wish I didn't have. I've been on tour for 34 years. This is not exactly the tour I wanted to go on. Let's put it that way.
Yet when you look at your house and you look at all that you've accomplished and the people mm-hmm. you've touched,
yes,
I mean that's pretty remarkable.
When I first started doing this, I just wanted to try and figure out some way that I could cope with this situation. And as I started to do it, I met a lot of other people who were either in a similar situation or they had some other problem. And by using my own experience to show other people what's possible, I started getting all these letters and calls, and now I get emails. And so people gave me a gift back. It came back to me in a way that, I know this is not the most important thing in the world. It's not even near the top of the list. But at least it's something positive. And every day I try to do something positive. And I know for a fact that I'm making a difference. And that makes me feel good. If I had this career for 34 years of doing trick shots, traveling around the country, hitting trick golf shots. If that was my career, I'd say that'd be terrific. But this makes it even better, because I know in some small way I'm making a difference. I'm able to help others who may have a physical problem. I'm able to help young people, give them a good positive message. And I think that makes me feel really well.
Have you had kids or young adults or whomever come up to you after one of your shows and talk to you about what they're going through?
I have people who've come up to me all the time, and there's every emotion you can think of. They're laughing, they're crying, they're telling me their own story. There's almost not a day that goes by that I don't get an email or a letter or some kind of communication from some person that has been to one of my shows. And I think one of the real telling things is I'll get somebody who comes up to me and they'll say, I saw your show 20 years ago. And they still remember everything about it, and they remember what I said. So I feel like this is good, because they have heard what I've been trying to say. So our show is Great Golf. It's always been about hitting great golf shots. But there's a point to it. There's a lot more to it than just golf. There's a point. And the point is, if I can do this, then I'm challenging each person in my audience to do something in their life that they didn't think they could. Maybe something they think is impossible. Maybe something people have told them you'll never be able to do. And this is really an important message for young people, I think, because they should always try to reach for their dreams and do something that they really want to do. If you could find something like that, I think you're on the right track. That's what we're encouraging. That's what makes our show different.
Can you tell me what happened during the accident? How did you end up paralyzed?
This was 35 years ago. I was in an old three-wheel golf cart. I was going down a steep hill. I wasn't going that fast, and that's about all I remember. The next thing I remembered, I was on the ground, and I didn't have a mark on me, I didn't have a scratch on me, but I couldn't get up. And I somehow dislocated a vertebrae, which pinched my spinal cord, so I'm paralyzed from the waist down.
So when you got to the hospital, and doctors examined you, what was your prognosis?
I think they knew right away, but no one told me. They told my mom and dad and my sister, but no one ever told me. I found out like 6 months later, because I thought I was always, because they said, well, they have to wait for the swelling to go down, and this could happen, that could happen, but nothing happened, and I kind of figured it out for myself about 6 months later. And I had a conversation with my doctor, and I said, well, am I ever going to be able to walk again? And he said, no. And that made me cry. And I said, well, how about playing golf? He said, forget it. And that made me mad. And so I eventually went back, and I showed him how I was playing golf and everything, and He promised he wasn't going to do that again.
So he knows now. But,
exactly.
Anger can be a great motivator.
Well, I was really angry about the whole situation. I really did. I'm still mad about it.
Really?
Yeah. Because there's just so many things I can't do that I want to do. The simplest things for you to do are probably some of the hardest things for me to do, and it never goes away. It's there every single second. If I could just take a break for a day, I think that would make me feel better. This has been 35 years. I mean, I'm less angry about it now than I was. I guess I've learned to cope with it. You have to try and make the best of it. The easiest thing to do is to give up. Anybody can do that, but lucky for me, I had a great mom and dad and a great sister, and they basically, I wasn't brought up to quit, and my dad actually went with me on tour for 17 years, and he did everything for me. My mom was great, she always did everything at home, and after 17 years, when my dad couldn't go anymore, my sister actually went with me, and I never could have done this by myself. I've done a lot of the heavy lifting here, but I never could have done it by myself. I mean, I have the calluses and on my hands to prove it, but still, without my mom and dad and my sister, I don't think there's any way I could have done it.
So what was it in you in those first few months that you had a lot of family support? Obviously, you had a wonderful family around you, and you were determined to prove the doctor wrong. But what, I mean, what is it in you that, made you say, I'm not giving up, and I'm gonna go out there and I'm gonna play golf?
I'm sure there's people out there who have an equal amount of love for golf. But ever since I played when I was 8 years old, it's just something that I really enjoyed. I love the challenge of the game. I love being out among nature. The first day I went to a golf course, I was about 8 years old. I saw a deer and a squirrel and birds and trees. And I said, oh, this is great. And I saw the ball being hit in the air. And I said, man, this is for me. And so that really kept me going. And I just, in the darkest days, the best I felt was when I went to the golf course. And when I was able to go there and be by myself and work out a lot of my problems, it had a tremendous impact on me. And I just kept doing it. And it was so frustrating because I knew the first day I sat down in that golf seat on the golf cart, I knew I'd never play as well as I did before. And that really bothered me for a long time. And one day I was sitting there and I was so mad, and I said, you know what, I think I'm looking at this wrong. I said, I shouldn't look, how did I used to play? How am I playing right now? Can I get any better? And once I realized that and I saw I was getting better, then I felt a lot better about the whole situation. My program is very wide ranging. The audience are widely mixed. We travel in a motorhome for about 6 months, and once we leave here in April, we're on the road, and every day is different.
Wow, that's quite an adventure.
Yeah, I have, it's a real adventure. I have a great assistant, Tom Kalenda, who goes with me. He's the one that does all the work. I just hit the golf balls, and my dog, Bucky, who I named after my dad, he's fantastic. He's just does so many tricks, and I've always had a dog in my show, and the dog is the opening act.
Fist bump, high five, high ten, high ten.
Attaboy, good job. Comes out, does his tricks, and everybody likes him.
How many points for a basket? What about a long basket? I'm going to ask him a couple questions about golf, then we'll take a few questions from the audience. What's the par on the 17th hole at Sawgrass? Very nice, that's correct. Okay. Can you tell me how many times Jack Nicklaus won the Masters? Six is right.
Yeah, he's like an extension of you. He's your best pal, huh?
I would say he's my best pal. He is. He's a service dog, so he helps me in real life, picks things up I can't reach, and therefore we're never separated. He goes to the movies with me, grocery stores, restaurants, anywhere I can go, he can go. He's been to Yankee Stadium, Fenway Park. He's been to Indianapolis.
He's dressed in a tux.
He has his own tux. Yes. Every show, I always like to point out, if you're looking for a dog or a cat, an animal shelter or a rescue group, it's a great place to begin your search.
Why do you feel so strongly about that cause?
If you go and visit as many of these animal shelters as I have, you'd be right behind me. I think it's a story that needs to be told. There are thousands, hundreds of thousands of these dogs. If you get one, you're saving a life, and you'll have a great pal. They're terrific. These dogs are not in there because they're bad. And a little TLC and a lot of love goes a long way.
You talk a lot about having a dream and pursuing your dream during your show. So after all that you've accomplished, and you've accomplished quite a lot, mm-hmm. What's your dream today?
Well, I figure I'm on the back nine here on my career. And what I want to do with the rest of my career, I want it to be a continuation of what I've been doing. My message is a universal message. I think it applies to everybody. Because every single person should have a dream. You're never too young, you're never too old to have a dream. And this is really important. If you have a dream and it doesn't work out, never stop dreaming. Get a new dream. And I guess I'm a perfect example of that. So right now, I want to particularly reach out to young people. I'm doing this through my relationship with the First Tee. The other thing I want to do is I want to encourage people with disabilities to get out and try the game of golf. Golf is not for everybody. If it's for you, it's a wonderful lifetime recreation. You can play long after you can't play the other sports. It's a great way to spend time with family and friends. And it's not just playing 18 holes of golf. I call it a golf experience. If you go out there and just hit golf balls on the driving range or putt with your friends or your kids, chipping golf balls in the backyard, anything like that that brings you close to the game is something that I think will pique a person's interest. So I'm trying to encourage people with disabilities to try this as a recreation that maybe it's something they never thought they could do, but it is possible, and it's a lot of fun. And so as part of that, I want to help and work with the military folks who have come back from overseas. As far as I'm concerned, you can't do enough for the men and women who have fought for us and made it so we can have this country the way it is. And so I want to show them what's possible and give them another area of recreation. And those are the things I really would like to do with the rest of my career.
Do you have a really selfish dream, something that's just for you?
I got a bucket list. I do have a bucket list. I wanted to go spend a day at Augusta National, and I did. I did that in the fall. I played a few holes. I had lunch there, best hamburger I've ever had, and I also played the par 3 course and went fishing in Ike's Pond. So that's how I spent the day with a buddy of mine, Danny Yates, from Augusta National. That was on my list. I want to do a show at St. Andrews in Scotland. I want to do that, do a show off the First Tee at St. Andrews, working on that. There's probably a few things I'd like to do. I've been to almost every famous golf course there is and done a show, so I've really enjoyed that. I haven't been to every one, but I've been to a lot of them in this country. I've done a show in 49 states, and this summer I'm hoping to do one in Alaska to complete my journey there. I would say that's about it. I would really like to keep doing what I've been doing for a while. This is the thing, doing my show is the thing that I really love to do the most, and I really want to continue to be able to do that for a long time. I would say that would be my big overall wish. I just want to keep doing it and keep doing it the way I've been doing it, because I know I've done over 2,800 of these, and I've never half-hearted one. Every one I try to do to the best of my ability, and I like that. And that's why I want to be able to keep doing this for a long time.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So, documentary.
I like to ask a lot of questions.
No, but see, it's like a minute and a half. How are you gonna?
Well, it might be like a minute 50 because we have good sound bites.
Okay. All right. Well.
See, the better the talker, the more I ask.
Hey, you're not in this, Buck. Down. Bucky. Down.
Doesn't have a SAG card, Dennis.
Oh, he's sitting on the squirrel.
You're sitting on the squirrel.
I can't tell you I've ever done that in my life.
Come down a little bit more like this. Let me see.
Is my makeup still okay?
You're good. All right, I'm all set. Calm down.
Cute. Okay. Yeah. You good?
Yeah.
Tell me about this letter. When did you get this?
Well, I got that on one of my worst days ever in the hospital. Ben Hogan was my golfing hero, and one day I had the worst day of all time, and I came back to my bed, and there was a letter waiting for me, and it was postmarked Fort Worth, Texas, and I went to school in Texas, and I had a lot of friends there, but I was really down, and I looked at it, and it said, Ben Hogan, Fort Worth, Texas, and I read that letter, and that really gave me a big boost. It really did, at a time where I really needed it, and I subsequently met him 6 times, and every time was like, wow, it was some memorable experience for sure. And if you look at the letter closely, you'll see there's a stain there on the right. That's a tear stain that I started crying when I read it. And it's a pretty cool letter.
What was it about that letter that...
It's basically about never to give up and always remember that good things can happen and recovery is possible if you're willing to work at it and hang in there. And I guess that's kind of what I did. I followed his advice to the letter.
And boy, it came at the right time. Huh?
It came at the perfect time. It really was. And after I won the Ben Hogan Award, he sent me this telegram. That's how long ago it was. But yeah, it was great. It's really cool to me that I got to meet my golfing hero, and he was great. He was fantastic, and he was so nice to me, and it really did mean a lot.
He was an actual hero.
He was.
Lived up to it.
Huh? He was to me, for sure.
Best wishes. Congratulations on your election to receive the trophy given in my name. How about that, huh?
Yeah, it's very cool.
Knowing of your background and dedication to promoting golf for the disabled, I am more than delighted at the committee's choice. Best wishes.
All right, I'm all set.
Ready?
Yeah.
Okay, this is the letter that Ben Hogan sent me when I was in the hospital. It says, Dear Denny, just recently I learned of your unfortunate accident, and with your permission, I would like to offer my thoughts and a word of encouragement. We know the human body is a great machine and can absorb many shocks. Even though it may seem slow, recovery is possible, provided one has faith, hope, will, and determination. From what I've heard about you, I am sure you possess these qualities. So please keep battling, and you will soon overcome this bad interlude in your life. All good wishes for the future. Sincerely, Ben. That's cool.
What about the teardrop on there?
Yeah, see this stain? This is the teardrop that I started crying when I read this. Yeah, I've cried a few times since then, but that's what that is. It was a really bad day, but it got better when I read this.